favorite song, but do the best that you can.
One more time. We delight. she was asked this question. I said, the Shabbat is a pulled out time. I said, it's a pulled out time to represent what's coming, the millennial reign. So he's giving you an example of what's going to be then. Does that make sense? I said, the Sabbath is a place out of time. Mm-hmm. He set it aside. I said, so when we do our worship and we do our Sabbath routines and we have rest and worship, that's part of what's going to be in the millennial reign. And so we're actually enjoying something that we're going to get to do for a long time.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah.
I'm excited about that. Hallelujah. Yeah.
You're welcome to sing this. Everybody knows it. I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Of the goodness
Do that one more time. All my life. Take a moment just give it a little bit of thanks.
Yes.
I've heard some great testimonies, but listen, for me, worship sometimes is just waiting. I'm not in a hurry to go to the next song. I just want, if you try to get too busy, you miss the voice.
Yes.
Because there's a phrase in that song, "Your goodness is running after me." Well, you know what? I think I need to slow down a little bit. Yeah, I don't want to run too far ahead.
Amen.
Yes. Thank you, Lord. You know, that's why I said, I might need to slow down.
Amen.
And I know on the radio, they don't like silence. But sometimes... Sometimes we're so busy talking that we don't give God a chance to say anything.
Yeah.
So can we just take, just keep playing, but we don't have to sing. There is so much I'm sure you can just think right now and say, oh my goodness, I want to thank you, God, for that.
Yes.
I want to bless your name for doing this, and I want to thank you for that. And just spend a moment thanking him, because I promise you, thanking him will get his attention. Thank you, Lord, for the wrecks that's been prevented. My goodness. And we hear it all the time. Somebody in Parkburg or Greenville or Anderson's wreck all the time. Thank you, Lord. And we heard the testimony about the little baby with the ear and how God heard the prayer. And God was with Tim when he had his surgery. God chose to heal him through the surgery. But I promise you, God was there watching the hands of the doctors and those who were doing the surgery. He was under the care. Give them thanks. Give them thanks. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Wait on you, great King.
Have your
way.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
This is the song here is a warrior song. The battle belongs to the Lord. Heavenly armor will enter the land. The battle belongs to the Lord. No weapon that's fashioned against us shall stand. The battle belongs to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. We sing glory and honor, power and strength to the Lord. When the power of darkness comes in like a flood, the battle belongs to the Lord. He's raised up a standard, the power of his blood. The battle belongs to the Lord, for we sing glory. Song's got nothing to do with my focus. Nothing.
Amen.
I don't care what you sing. I'll go my own world and worship. I don't need to know the words.
Amen.
I mean, if that's not worship. It's words. Worship's here.
Yeah. Amen.
You know, if I don't know, I hum. I'll hum in the spirit. I'll sing in the spirit. I'm going to worship.
Hallelujah.
I'm not going to just sit on the sidelines. That's not my call. That's not your call.
Amen.
This one, I don't know where this song come from, but we were flipping through stuff. And this is an old song. You probably don't know who it is. Mylon LeFevre and Broken Heart. So, see? Y'all old. Tim, you tell me probably. Yeah. Mylon LeFevre, oh my God. And it's really easy. This is not a hard song.
Holy, holy is the Lord.
Say it's a humdinger, but I got one for you today, and it's all scripture. Everything that's going on in the Word of God is scripture, but most of what's going on in this world is scripture right now too. And I've got to be careful to not stand up here and sound like Alex Jones sometimes, because the conspiracies run deep. They really, everything is going on right now. We've got the BRICS nations, and we've got more and more powerful nations that are joining with them, and they're trying to release their own gold-backed currency, which, if you don't know history, you don't understand what's going on. A gold-backed currency is what got Gaddafi, I can't even say his name right. Libya. Gaddafi? You guys are worse than me. Okay, but that's what got him killed. I've heard that's what got Saddam Hussein killed. There's a lot of them that have tried to go against the petrodollar, and it's costed them their life. They've come against the central banks, and that's not what we're talking about today. But we're like literally on the edge of the prophecies being fulfilled, to where we don't have to worry about, what's it like to be in the presence of God? What's it going to be like when he splits the sky? You're not going to be asking those questions anymore, because this generation will be the generation that sees it. Amen. You won't be asking what it's like. You'll be thinking back to what it was like. Amen. The king will be sitting on his throne. These earthly kings will be no more. It won't be as it is right now. There's so much that goes through my mind. There's such a danger. There's been men stand up before, and they had a vision, and they tried to build God's kingdom. I know most of you weren't alive at the time, but what was his name? Jim Jones?
Yes.
They followed after this guy, and he's promising them this utopia and this kingdom of God on earth and all this stuff. And man gets that power. I don't think he was good to begin with. But men get this power in their hands, and their head goes, whoop. And the next thing you know, they're drinking cyanide-laced Kool-Aid.
Yeah.
Right. It's just the way. There's not going to be a man-made kingdom of God on the earth. We're not going to create the kingdom and then he returns. He will come and he will establish his throne. We are on his side, yes. But we're not going to be the ones that instituted. It's his timing. And he's the one that's going to come and he's the one that's going to do it. Let's go to Matthew. We're going to go to the 24th chapter. Of course, can't talk about the end of time without talking about Matthew, the 24th chapter. We're going to pick up in the third verse. And it says, "And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?" And I love the first thing that Jesus tells them, because this is so important. "And Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you." Because there's deceivers everywhere out there. They come in the name of God. They come in the name of other gods. But there's all kinds of deceivers out there that want to tell you. And Jesus is preparing his disciples 2,000 years ago. When they come and tell you he's in the desert,
yeah,
don't bother.
Yeah.
He's not in the desert. Because when he appears, every eye is going to see him. And they that pierced him, they're all going to know. There's not going to be any question. There's not going to be some man that you hear rumors about that are working miracles and preaching. No, he's coming for everybody. Everybody. Every eye shall see him. There's not going to be a question who the Messiah is. There will be those that stand up with this lawless doctrine. They're going to stand up and they're going to tell you, don't worry about what the Bible says is right and what the Bible says is wrong, because it's all by grace. There's no law. There's nothing to follow. That's a false Christ.
Yeah. Amen.
That's a false system.
Amen.
That is a false religion.
Amen.
What is right and what is wrong has already been established.
Amen.
How you deal with it, what you're going to do with it, is what we need to worry about, because it's already been established.
Yes.
But he said, "Take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in divers places, nation against nation," the Greek ethnos against ethnos. I don't know if you guys have been paying attention to what's going on with AI recently, but they're letting it have its run out there. And they say, like, create a picture of the founding fathers, and it's black dude. Because we've got on this side, they're wanting racial division. They're wanting ethnos against ethnos. They're wanting race against race. They want blacks against Asia. They want Asian against whites, because they cannot have a united people standing in front of them. So they have to splinter us into nothing. And that's what they're attempting to do right now. Jesus says it'll be nation against nation, ethnos against ethnos. And there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes. These goobers out there with this COVID. Sorry. What's the key word? How do I say this?
Vaseline.
But yeah, the ones that were pushing the Vaseline. We'll go that way so we don't get booted online here. But the ones that were pushing the Vaseline, there's like 72 million, I think is the word I heard, of people that have died from the Vaseline. Vaseline-related illnesses. There's been millions more. Double that at the least, that have starved to death because of the policies they put into place. They didn't care anything about the disease. What they care about is the control that they had established over the people. What they cared about is the fear they had established in the hearts of the people. But no matter how much they want to tell you that there is no God, no matter how much they want to instill that fear, Jesus told them 2,000 years ago that the fear was going to be here, and he tells us to fear not.
Amen. 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 Hallelujah.
And earthquakes in divers places. I think I know for sure Joe and Jonathan were still home, but we lived in Blacksburg. And I was sitting there one Sunday on the couch, and I don't know if I was looking at Facebook or what it was, but they were back there in the bedroom romping around. You could feel the whole house shaking. It wasn't my boys romping around. It was an earthquake in Virginia. I don't remember that ever happening before. You could feel the house shake. I mean, it wasn't coming down on top of us, but we didn't have earthquakes before. That Lee Stone King, he's up in upstate New York, Catskill Mountains, is that how you say that? He was up there, and he said he was laying in bed, and he's from California, I think, originally, so he knew what it was, and he's laying there, and he's shaking while he's laying there in bed, and he's saying, we don't have earthquakes in New York. There's earthquakes in divers places. All these signs that Jesus gave us are coming to pass. It's not time to fear.
Amen.
It's time to use this time to draw closer to Him. You've got nothing to fear.
Amen.
You've got nothing to worry about. This word will come to pass.
Amen.
He will establish his throne, and he will be King of Kings.
Amen.
He shall reign over all the earth.
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen.
Verse 8, all these are the beginning of sorrows. Strong's G5604, sorrows, a pang or throe, especially of childbirth.
Amen.
Because something is getting ready to come forth.
Amen.
First time you have a child, it freaks you out a little. I guess I can announce that because everybody's going to know anyway. They already saw it on Facebook. The first time you have a child, your wife has a contraction, and then you go to the hospital and they say it's Braxton Hicks. I became good friends with Braxton Hicks. I had coffee with him and everything. You go back to the hospital, it's Braxton Hicks. And then you go back to the hospital and say, well, no, that's really a contraction.
Yep.
3 hours later, well, that's another contraction.
Yep.
2 hours and 20 minutes later, that's another contraction. An hour later, 10 minutes later, 1 minute later, 30 seconds later, not to scare you or anything. But when the child comes forth, the Bible tells us we forget all about the pain.
Yeah.
We forget about everything that we went through to get to that point. Birth pains are over with. The King is on his throne. Believe me, the child will think it's the King. Somebody get me 1 Thessalonians 5. Get me verses 1 through 6.
But of the times and the seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them.
What do we got now? What's going on now? Well, you know what you got to do. We've got to send this $60 billion over to the Ukraine, and then we'll have peace and safety here, and they can keep their war over there. When they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them. Go ahead.
As travail upon a woman with child.
Sounds familiar.
And they shall not escape. But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that day should overtake you as a thief. Ye are all the children of the light, and the children of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness.
There is no reason for what is happening now in the news to take any of us by surprise. There's no reason there's so much stuff I want to stand up here and say because there's so much I see and it just aggravates the snot out of me. But these things have to come to pass. They have to because it was spoken. I'm not a fan of Vladimir Putin. I'm not a fan of Joe Biden. I'm not a fan of Donald Trump. But these people are chess pieces in a game. If they die, it will be somebody else that is raised up in their place. Because that's all they are. Don't try to tell them they're pawns. They got egos that big. All of them. But they're just pawns. And they're being moved around. They're being put into position for the end game. But what the devil doesn't realize for whatever reason is when mate is finally put into place, it's going to be God checkmating him.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes. Ezekiel, the 38th chapter, speaking of Vladimir Putin. Pooty Poot, wasn't that what Bush called him? Pooty Poot. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, set thy face against God. The land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshech and Tubal, and prophesy against him, and say, Thus saith the Lord God, Behold, I am against thee, O Gog, the chief prince of Meshech and Tubal, and I will turn thee back, and will put hooks into thy jaws, and I will bring thee forth in all thine army, horses and horsemen, and all of them clothed with all sorts of armor, even a great company with bucklers and shields, and of them handling swords. Well, you wonder why I'm laughing when I'm reading this. I'm thinking if we put Joe Biden in charge of their economy, it probably will be on horseback. He's already sold off our strategic petrol reserve. He sold off all of our oil. They're trying to make our army EV. They're trying to have these military vehicles run on battery power. Are they really that dumb? Are they inspired to be that dumb? Or is there something sinister behind them that's causing them to do this? Either way, it's the same result. I mean, the same thing is going to happen. But when I read this, and I read that God is going to put a hook in his jaw, Putin this whole time, he's called the king of the north here also, and you've got Israel here, you've got Syria here, you've got Turkey here, you've got the Ukraine here, and then you've got Russia. Who's the one that we're going to worry about in all of that? We're going to worry about Russia because they are the largest nation. They are the largest power. He says, I am going to put a hook in your jaw and I'm going to draw you to the battle. He said, I don't want war in Ukraine. I want the property that belongs to us, is what Putin is saying. I want the property back that belongs to us. They can have the rest of it. Russia was born in Ukraine. They were Russia. Their people speak mostly Russian. So, don't want war. And then he says, if you send fighters, you're going to have war. We send fighters. You send tanks, we're going to have war. They send tanks. If you let Ukraine join NATO, you're going to have a war. Everything he says, I don't want war. I don't want war. Now the French are trying to get NATO involved up in there. They're trying their best to start a war. Because this is going to be the war that kicks it all off. This is going to be what happens. He's going to come out of the north. I will turn thee back and put hooks into thy jaws, and I will bring thee forth in all thine army, horses and horsemen, all of them clothed with all sorts of armor, even a great company with bucklers and shields, all of them handling swords. Persia, you guys know that's Ethiopia, that's not a big secret. Ethiopia. Persia's Iran. Ethiopia, Libya, they still have the same names, they're still in the same places. Ethiopia is kind of like at the bottom of the Red Sea, like Egypt's over here. Ethiopia is over here. But Ethiopia, Libya with them, all of them with shield and helmet. Gomer and all his bands, the house of Togarmah, of the north quarters and all his bands and many people with thee. Be thou prepared and prepare for thyself, thou and all thy company that are assembled unto thee, and be thou a guard unto them. Let's go over to Ezekiel 39. I'm going to pick up in verse 7. Josiah, go get me Zechariah, the 14th chapter.
Yes, sir.
Because we can't talk about this without going to Zechariah, the 14th chapter. Because I read that chapter and get all excited. Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen. Ezekiel, the 39th chapter, we're going to pick up in verse 7. So will I make my holy name known in the midst of my people Israel, and I will not let them pollute my holy name anymore. And the heathen shall know that I am the Lord,
Amen.
The Holy One in Israel. Do you see why we want to be part of that covenant?
Amen.
Do you understand why we want to be joined with Israel? We don't want to be Gentiles. Amen. We want to be part of the covenant that God made with Abraham. We Amen. Want to be grafted in because we want to worship the Holy One yes. of Israel.
Amen.
He is the Holy One of Israel, not New Jersey.
Amen. Amen.
Not Zimbabwe. Not Japan.
Amen.
He's the Holy One of Israel.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Behold, it is come and it is done, saith the Lord. This is the day whereof I have spoken. And they that dwell in the cities of Israel shall go forth and set on fire and burn the weapons, both shields and bucklers, and bows and the arrows and the hand staves and the spears. And they shall burn them with fire 7 years. So that they shall take no wood out of the field, neither cut down any trees out of the forest, for they shall burn the weapons with fire, and they shall spoil those that spoiled them, and rob those that robbed them. And it shall come to pass in that day that I will give unto Gog a place there of graves in Israel, the valley of the passengers on the east of the sea, and it shall stop the noses of the passengers, and they shall bury Gog and all his multitude, and they shall call it the valley of Ammon Gog. And 7 months shall the house of Israel be burying them, that they may cleanse the land. This is coming to pass. Zechariah 14, give me 1 through 9. Michaela, go get me Isaiah 46, verses 9 and 10.
Behold, the day of the Lord cometh, and thy spoil shall be divided in the midst of thee. For I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle, and the city shall be taken, and the houses rifled, and the women ravaged. And half of the city shall go forth into captivity, and the residue of the people shall not be cut off from the city. Then shall the Lord go forth and fight against those nations as when he fought in the day of battle. And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives.
When we come to this point that Josiah is reading about the earlier part, the enemy has come down onto Jerusalem. And the enemy has infiltrated Jerusalem, and it's looking like everything's going to be destroyed. There's going to be no more Israel. It's all going to be gone. And then the one that they pierced. We've had problems before with certain people in the churches that could only preach truth, but they didn't have enough truth. But they used to preach that Jesus, when he ascended, that the disciples saw him, and then when he got up so far, his body just went poof in the dust, and that was it. No more Jesus. He was just a spirit, and after that, a disembodied spirit. That's not what the Bible teaches at all. And matter of fact, the same scripture where they're trying to tell us that poof, no more body of Jesus, the same place where they're trying to say that, in like manner, you're going to, well, where was he?
The Mount of Olives.
Imagine that.
Not a saddest day journey from Jerusalem.
Imagine that. He came down, and the mountain's going to go in the body.
Amen.
Because they're going to recognize that it's Yeshua.
Amen.
And they that pierced him, well, how are they going to know? Because that generation's dead. How are they going to know? Because somehow that flesh that doesn't exist anymore has nail prints in his hands and in his feet and a spear print in his side. They that pierced him are going to see, and it says that they are going to weep and they are going to mourn as a man mourns over the death of his only son. Because they're going to realize what they did. But he comes and saves them anyway.
Amen.
Now go ahead, Joseph. Hallelujah. This is the good part. It's all good.
And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem on the east. And the Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst thereof, toward the east and toward the west. And there shall be a very great valley. And half of the mountain shall remove toward the north, and half of it toward the south. And ye shall flee to the valley of the mountains, for the valley of the mountains shall reach unto Azal. Yea, ye shall flee, like as he fled from before the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. And the Lord my God shall come, and all the saints with thee. And it shall come to pass in that day that the light shall not be clear nor dark, but it shall be one day which shall be known to the Lord, not day nor night. But it shall come to pass that at evening time it shall be light.
Okay, I'm sorry, Joe. Stay right there. I'm not going to have you knock off and go anywhere else. But he's going to come, and who's going to be with him?
Saints.
Well, they're disembodied spirits too at this point, aren't they? No, no. Aubrey, do you have a Bible? Get me Jude 14. And 15. And I'm sorry, but Jude's going to quote from one of the naughty books that we can't read. Go ahead.
And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints.
He's going to return, and when he does, he's going to return with 10,000s. Not 10,000. It's not a number. It's one of those no man can number. What's 10,000s? It's plural. It's very plural. Amen. He's coming with 10,000s of his saints, and we're going to find out where they come from here in just a minute. Go ahead and finish that.
To execute judgment upon all, and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed, and all of their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him.
Amen. That's good. Go ahead, Josiah.
And it shall be in that day that living waters shall go out from Jerusalem.
Yes.
Half of them toward the former sea, and half of them toward the hinder sea. In summer and in winter shall it be, and the Lord shall be king over all the earth. And that day there shall there be one Lord, and his name one.
Amen. And that one Lord is going to reign over all the earth.
Yes.
There's not going to be some kind of Marxist utopia set up where everybody's got everything that they need and we all just throw it into the... You know what? Honestly, if you could make it work, I'd be communist. I would. If you could make it work. But you can't make it work because the apostles of our Lord tried it. They couldn't make it work. They walked with Jesus all that time, and they couldn't make it work. There won't be a Marxist utopia. There won't be a man-made utopia. He is going to come, and he is going to reign over the entire earth. Isaiah 46, 9 and 10.
Remember the former things of old, for I am God, and there is none else. I am God, and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure.
Amen. He spoke all of this from the beginning. There's not a single thing that has happened in history where God stood up and said, oh no, what am I going to do now? Adolf Hitler's killing Jews. What am I going to do now? Americans are killing the Indians. What am I going to do now? He knew it was all going to happen. It doesn't mean that he sanctioned them doing that, but that he knows what is inside man. He knows what man is going to do. How many of you guys play chess? I know I taught a handful of you. When you're playing chess, you're trying your best to stay two or three moves ahead of your opponent, to having some idea what they are going to do next. People think Satan is some kind of berserker, that he's going to come out there for 3.5 years just wildly swinging and out there doing all this stuff. No, he's been getting his pieces in place too. That's all this is a chess game. But God's going to have him in checkmate. Because he declared the end from the beginning.
Amen.
Really what it comes down to is, whose side are you wanting to stand on? Who do you want to be in covenant with? Because the winner's been declared. It's already. He says the works were finished from the foundation of the world. It's not like this is some great mystery. Are there mysteries in the Word of God? Yes, but this is not one of them. He wins.
Amen. Yes. That's true.
Revelation 6, 14 through 17. Okay, if you've got that, Josiah, go get me Luke.
Yes, sir.
21, 25, and 26.
And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and
the chief, 17.
And the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us, and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand?
It's not that I throw these names out there and that I have any particular animosity toward these people, but Mark Zuckerberg is putting hundreds of millions of dollars into having the rocks fall on him and saying, hide me from the face of him who sits on the throne. He's gone out. He's bought his own Hawaiian island. But they are doing this. This is actually the people that are in business that are building these things. Business is booming. Where you've got a lot of the population that can't afford to feed itself, these overly wealthy people are out there and they're having bunkers installed in their property all over the place. It's not something new. The government did it years ago. They've got bunkers all over the place. But the rich people, they were doing it in New Zealand a few years ago. I've heard that's what that fire was about in Hawaii. Was it last year? I believe so. But I've heard that's what that was all about. They were trying to buy up the property cheap. But these people know what's coming. They're evil, but they think they're going to one-up God. You're not. Get on his side or just forget it. Luke 21, 25, and 26. Jonathan, can you read real loud back there? Get me first. Oh, boy. Carrie, can you read real loud back there? Get me 1 Thessalonians, the 4th chapter, 14 through 18. Go get me Psalm 145, verse 13. Okay, go ahead.
And there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations, with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken.
Men's hearts failing them for fear. That is true because it's written in the Word of God, but right now men's hearts are failing them because of the Vaseline.
No.
That's all over the place. People are dropping dead left and right. People that shouldn't be. People that are young. People that are in shape. And they're still falling over left and right from this. I'm not trying to give you bad news. I'm trying to give you good news. 1 Thessalonians 4, 14 through 18.
For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore comfort one another with these words.
We live in an era where people have gotten so at home in the world that the people that are supposed to be standing with God are just as concerned as the people that are standing with Satan about losing everything. Where the early church said, hey, the Lord's coming back to take his church. The Lord's coming back to reign. Comfort one another with these words.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
And they're all freaking out, worried about this, worried about that. Yeah, it's going to be a bummer for a while, you know? And we've got a promise in the book of Revelation that if you are killed in that time period, you will be part of the first resurrection and you will reign with him
Amen.
For 1,000 years.
Amen.
Amen.
Pretty good retirement plan.
Amen. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah.
That works for me. This earth's got nothing to hold on to.
Amen.
But the king is coming.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And when the king comes and the king reigns, everything that is wrong will be righted.
Yeah.
Amen.
I've been listening to a financial guy on YouTube, and he talks about we're coming down into the period of time where you have the haves and the have-nots and the have-yachts.
Yeah.
Because the division is getting so greatly, and they're doing everything they can to destroy the middle class. They don't want you working. They want to take care of you so they can tell you what you're going to put into your body, what you're going to put into your mouth. They want to tell you where you can travel. They've already have the designs of these 15-minute cities, and 15 minutes is all you get. We're going to load up in the car this year, and we're going to go to the EFC over in Nashville, Tennessee. That's going to be over with. They're doing everything they can to prohibit your traveling.
Yep.
He is selling off the strategic oil reserve that we have. Gasoline is going to become in short supply. They're going to do the same thing with these cars as they did with guns. They didn't outlaw guns. They made it hard to get ammunition. Yep. What good's a weapon you can't practice with? You've got to learn how to shoot it. They shut down the lead smelters. They've shut down all of that. These people are not stupid. And that's the reason why it gets me. Sometimes, yes, I see the demented old man. I see him do things that leave me scratching my head. But either he's a very good actor or there's somebody behind him pulling strings. Because these people make moves that make them look like blundering idiots, but it's genius. Because they're of their father, the devil. They're making their moves. They're making their moves. All I'm trying to tell you is be prepared.
Yeah.
Don't be so much at home in this world that you're loath to give it up because you got something better coming too.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Psalm 145, verse 13. Did I give anybody Hebrews? I want to get that because I like that one myself. Somebody else give me Isaiah 9.
Verse 13?
Yes, 145, verse 13.
Thy kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and thy dominion endureth throughout all generations.
Thy kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Just like when I read Zechariah, the 14th chapter, I get giddy the same way I do when I read Daniel, the 2nd chapter. I don't get giddy about the statue, and I don't get giddy about it busted into pieces. It's about that stone that was cut out of the mountain without hands that did the busting up, and it becomes a mountain and it fills the whole earth. Amen. That kingdom is an everlasting Amen. Kingdom Amen. That will always stand.
Amen.
Let's go over here, Hebrews, the 11th chapter. I'm going to pick up in the 8th verse. By faith, Abraham. You guys know where Abraham lived? He lived in He was part of a kingdom that was on earth. He was born into this kingdom. This is not long after the time of Nimrod and Sumerian, I believe, was the name of the culture that was in that area at the time that they had. It was the first empire, Sargon, I believe. Or am I getting the Lord of the Rings thrown in here? I can't remember which. But Sargon, anyways, he was the first emperor, and it was Nimrod. It was Nimrod. This is where Abraham is born into. We have things that didn't make it into the Bible because it's not considered canon, where Abraham goes in and he busts up the statues, the little gods of his father. God's calling Abraham out of a system that 4,000 years later, we're still standing in it.
Amen.
Sometimes the names change. Sometimes the names don't even change.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
But it's the same system that is all over the world. And God is 4,000 years ago. Abraham, you go into a land that I'm going to tell you about. And I'm going to give it to your descendants. And I am going to raise up to them a kingdom that's going to be an everlasting kingdom.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
People think it's Israel. Not yet. David was a great king, don't get me wrong. But this is an eternal kingdom that we're talking about.
Amen.
This is going to be something. And the only way that the eternal is going to happen is through the eternal God.
Yeah.
Because we are finite beings. We are born that way as finite beings. You will not have a male king of kings that is flesh like we are flesh. He is a glorified body, and in him dwelleth the fullness of the Godhead bodily.
Yeah.
We're not going to be trying to rule the world. Thank God. We've seen what men can do.
Amen.
But he's coming, and he's going to restore. And I was the one reading this. I can't tell somebody to go ahead and read when I'm the one reading. When he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obey. And he went out, not knowing whither he went. By faith he sojourned in the land of promise as in a strange country. The property was given to him by promise, but he's dwelling there as a stranger, but it's his property. That's where we are with the kingdom. You can go to Israel or whatever. You can go. It all belongs to the Lord, but it has not yet been manifest. It's coming. But wait, there's more. By faith he sojourned in the land of promise as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise, for he looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Men's kingdoms are going to rise. Men's kingdoms are going to fall. You can go back in history and you can argue some of the better rulers, some of the worst rulers. Oliver Cromwell, he fascinates the living daylights out of me, but he was a strong man during the English Revolution. He was a strong man at the end of that, and he tried his best and did a pretty good job keeping things lined up for a while. Then he died. Then his son comes up, and his son's just not as strong. So they end up giving it to Charles II, the son of the guy that they whacked the head off the first one. So they needed a second one. But, I mean, the point is, man cannot rule, because even when you have a good ruler, they're going to pass away. Something's going to happen. They're going to be gone. But the King of Kings is eternal.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah. It's not going to be, oh, boy, we're sorry to see he died. Nope. We've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun.
Amen.
We've no less days to sing God's praise than for when we first begun.
Amen.
He's eternal.
Hallelujah.
He's eternal.
Amen.
He'll give you that within yourself, but it still belongs to him.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. Somebody get me Isaiah 9, 6, and 7.
Oh,
Sister Gaiola. I can't call you Pookie. Sister Gaiola. Get me 2 Peter, 3rd chapter. Go ahead.
For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders.
Okay, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. The Constitution was a good government, but it couldn't go far enough. Men weren't willing to go far enough with that. Or how can I say that it didn't go far enough? Freedom of religion should have never existed. If they were Christian men, then it should not have existed, because we shouldn't have false religions coming into a quote-unquote Christian nation.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have the freedom to blaspheme my God.
Yeah.
That should be the way anybody feels that is truly walking for God. So, although it was a good document, it could not do what needed to be done, but the government shall be upon his shoulders, not my problem. Amen. Egypt didn't want to come to tabernacles. He turns off their reign, not my problem. Go ahead.
And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end.
The increase of the government and his peace, there shall be no end. And it doesn't mean like it is now. There's no end to our bureaucracy either. There's no end to little offices and men in polyester suits and Coke bottle glasses that are making regulations for us to live by. But that's not what that means. It means he's going to rule and there's no end to his rule.
Amen.
But there is no end to the bureaucracy until he returns. Go ahead.
Upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this.
Amen. 2 Peter, 3rd chapter, 10 through 15.
But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness? Looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness.
Amen.
Amen. What's righteousness? Well, it's already defined by the law of God. Will be done. He'll be the one ruling. Amen. 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 Jonathan, can you shut the camera off?